It's great to be here in Woods Hole, where generally speaking, people care about the ocean. But the first question to put forth is, why don't most people care about the sea? It really is the big mystery of the ocean. So I put this question once to Claire Booth Luce, a brainy person who is a statesman and a big thinker. And this was in Hawaii, and she just looked up where the fluffy white clouds were drifting by, and she said, it's really simple, my dear. Heaven is that way. You know what's that way. So maybe that is part of it, that we're always looking up, you know, getting in over your head is not a good idea, things like that. But I think the biggest reason is ignorance. People take the ocean for granted. They think that it's so big, so vast, that there isn't much that we can do to harm it, and even if we do, so what? That, at least until fairly recently, has been the case. People haven't cared about the ocean and what's beneath the surface nearly as much as investing in what's up in the sky. We have invested in what goes skyward, and it's paid off handsomely, but we've neglected the ocean, and it's costing us dearly. So, why should people care about the ocean? Well, because it keeps us alive. Is that good enough? The ocean contributes most of the oxygen to the atmosphere, grabs carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, shapes planetary chemistry. It is the home for most of life on Earth. It's where most of the water is. There are a lot of good reasons why people should care about the ocean. But okay, let's assume that you do care, and you realize that the ocean is in trouble, and the afterthought of that is, and therefore, so are we. What can we do about it? What can we as individuals, what can we as human civilization at this critical point in history do to make a difference? Well, in a way, that's primarily what I want to talk about today. I fell in love with the ocean when I was a little kid. I think part of it was inspired by reading William Beebe's book, Half Mile Down, even before I read Silent World and was inspired later by Cousteau. But reading about how William Beebe and Otis Barton, back in the 1930s, before I was born, they were diving in a little bathysphere and seeing creatures that nobody else had seen alive ever before. And it was a pretty gutsy thing to do when you think about it. Otis Barton was the designer of this thing. There they are. This is real footage of those two crazy characters. This is a little recreation that the National Geographic cooked up just to get a feel for what it must have been like to be lowered on a cable down as much as half a mile beneath the surface. And then, as Beebe describes it in his writings about how it's like diving in a galaxy of life, but the moons, the comets, and suns and stars are living creatures. Well, now, we lucky people who have come along at this point in time can, with a mask and flippers, just diving at night, and with a suite of variations on the theme of submersibles and remotely operated systems, actually get glimpses of what it's like in the ocean, to see bioluminescence, what Dr. Edith Witter says is the most common form of communication on the planet, perhaps, this flash and sparkle and glow of creatures that communicate with light. Most of the life on Earth lives in the dark. What a concept, because most of life on Earth, first of all, is in the ocean. Below 1,000 feet or so, it's dark all of the time. It's dark some of the time everywhere, but in the deep sea, except for living light, it's dark all of the time, not just in places like Washington, D.C. Did I say that? Oh, I did say that. Oh, well. Life on Earth, there it is in the sea. And I know many of you have taken the plunge. My mother waited until she was 81 to put on a mask and flippers and scolded me ever after for not getting me there sooner. So if you're 81, don't wait any longer. If you aren't, then don't wait any longer. There's more time. This area where Beebe and Barton had that first glimpse of the deep is also home just the edge of the Sargasso Sea, an area that harbors a floating golden forest of light, of life, where some creatures are found there and nowhere else. For others, it's a way station, like for turtles, for young tunas. It's a place where eels migrate to spawn. And I suppose the little eels spend a little bit of time sheltered in a way by the floating mass of sargassum weed that provides in the open sea a safe haven. Well, this is part largely of the high seas. 64% of the Earth's surface, of the ocean surface that, and depths below, that are in the areas beyond national jurisdiction. And it's something really to think about. What are the places on the planet where we have the least disturbance, the least impact of humankind? Well, the polar areas, for sure, although we're certainly impacting them indirectly through the warming trend that we just heard about. But more than that, it's the inaccessibility of polar regions and the deep sea that have kept them largely intact. And it's a challenge for our time, thinking about what can we do to stabilize the way the world works, to try to protect the natural systems that keep us alive. That's what we really must focus on if we are to succeed in leaving the place at least as good as we found it. So, back to the Arctic. The Arctic Ocean, it is a big body of mostly frozen water surrounded by mostly frozen land. The polar seas, areas that until fairly recently have just been regarded as so remote, so inaccessible, that they pretty much have taken care of themselves. It's on our watch that the fate of these areas, and thus the fate, the direction of the world, will be determined. What we do, or what we fail to do, will have a magnified impact on everything that follows. Can you imagine if a spacecraft went off to, like, Europa, one of the moons of Jupiter, and came back with some evidence of life, some real tangible evidence that there's life elsewhere in the universe, at least in our solar system. And here we've got bowhead whales, can live to be as much as 200 years, we think. Fellow vertebrates that have a recipe for life that exceeds our lifespan by 2 times, as far as we know. What about the little guys that have been around for hundreds of millions of years? And what their future will be will largely be determined by our actions in the next few years. Microbes will likely persist one way or the other, no matter what we do or don't do. But our challenge, the challenge of our time, is to so manage ourselves that we have a planet that works on our behalf. We being self-centered creatures that we are, life will go on. But will there be birds diving as they do today in search of food in the high Arctic? Will there be a planet that actually favors not just walruses, but humans? I had a call in August of 2007. It was from Anatoly Sagalovich, who's the designer of the mirror submersibles in Russia. The conversation was something like this. It wasn't a conversation, it was actually just a message. I missed the call. He said, "Sylvia, I am calling you from the North Pole." We had talked about going there together, because the North Pole has never, until 2007, been accessed, the real North Pole. But there he was. He said, "We missed you." And then I could hear clinking of glasses in the background. Clearly it was vodka, a celebration. He said, "This is a great accomplishment for science. We have reached the North Pole, but it was our accomplishment. Ta-da, Russia, they planted a titanium flag in the heart of the Arctic at the real North Pole." Well, it was thought that in 1909 that the real North Pole had been reached with Robert Perry and Matthew Henson. And of course it was at the top. But how much of the ocean has yet to be explored? It isn't just under the ice in the Arctic. It's most of the world. About 5% is all that has been seen, let alone explored or mapped. Now we have the capacity, though, to map, to explore, to take measurements and see the reduction of ice in the high Arctic. Good news for shipping, bad news for polar bears, for the people of the Arctic, whose lives depend on keeping the place pretty much the way it is now, for the people of the world to maintain the stability of the planet that's working pretty well to our advantage as it is now. What can we do to stabilize things so that we do have a planet that works in our favor, works in the favor of creatures who, as far as we know, like human beings, have no other place to go? Earth is it. If we fail to take care of this planet, I mean, it's a dream to perhaps go to other planets to set up housekeeping, but all things considered, if we don't make a way for ourselves here, this is it. Let's look at the other end of the Earth. I hope. Nope, sorry. Can we go back? Can you help me go back, please? There we go. This is, I can drive submarines. Not so sure about this. Just a glimpse, just to reinforce. You know, Earth is bipolar. We have this glorious effect of ice at both ends that does shape climate and weather, drives the currents, makes Earth a hospitable place for us. Well, of course, ice ages have come, ice ages have gone. Earth has been very different in times past. And we have come along during this very special time when humankind has truly prospered. We can do things that no other creature on Earth can do. We have the ability to go high in the sky and look down and see what's going on. I mean, whales are brainy. They're smart. Elephants are known to be intelligent. Cats, dogs, horses. But we're the only ones who can put ourselves in perspective and do something about our actions that will have a magnified impact on everything else. In some ways, we are the planet's worst nightmare, considering how we have affected the way the world works. But we're also the best hope. And that's cause for excitement, exhilaration even, that for the first time in all of human history, in all of Earth history, there is a creature, that would be us, with the power to know, to gather information, to store information over thousands of years, and especially in the last few centuries, and more particularly in the last few decades, the ability to gather, to learn about our fellow creatures like the penguins, to value them, to want to know more about how they live and what they do and how our lives relate to theirs, how we can perhaps do what it takes on our watch to secure an enduring future for all of the what has been referred to as the nuts, the bolts, the cogs, the wheels that hold the world together. Otto Leopold's comment about the diversity of life. All of this matters. We are the only ones who can sort of figure out why it matters and why taking care of everything from the plankton to the polychaetes to the pachyderms to whatever it is, these are all parts, the living systems that keep us alive. It's only about now that we've been able to put enough of the pieces together to appreciate that our lives are dependent, not just on water, not just on the fact that Earth exists a certain distance from the sun and all of the other things that make this place special, but because of life on Earth. We have the capacity to unravel the ecosystems that shape the chemistry of the planet that keeps us alive, or we have the power through knowing that we need to protect the land and the sea and the creatures who live there. Early in the 20th century, Theodore Roosevelt and his colleagues got the bright idea that we really have to protect nature. And owing to having a president in office at just the right time, much of this country was established as national parks during a critical phase when they were really under great pressure for exploitation, much as today. The ocean is under great pressure for exploitation, for commercial fishing, for mining, for oil and gas extraction, for shipping across the surface without really understanding what the consequences of some of the actions that we are doing to the ocean may be doing back to us. Well, it's now changing in terms of our ability to know this blue speck in the universe. For the first time, we have the technology to hold the world in our hands, to be able to fly around, to look at places like the Gulf of Mexico, and one little speck there in the northern Gulf called the Flower Garden Banks, a little bit of that that has been protected for a few years. In the Bahamas, there are places. It looks like the Bahamian government is thinking boldly about what it can do in its own exclusive economic zone to actually protect the fish. Or go off the Patagonian shelf, well, there's an area that penguins love, and squid love, and on the shore, on the land, well known for its beautiful ecosystems there, but it's currently at risk, as is most of the world. A fraction of 1% of the ocean has any form of protection for the fish and other creatures that live there. About 1%, if you put it all together, the Northwest Hawaiian Islands, the new Chagos Archipelago, Marine Reserve, 500,000 square kilometers established by the UK earlier this year. All of this together amounts to about 1% of the ocean, managed areas and fully protected areas together. It's really not quite enough. If you ask Barry, Napoleon Rass in Australia, if you listen closely, he'll tell you that the ocean is in trouble, but you can do something about it. On Google Earth, you can fly around, you can actually meet Barry, the Napoleon Rass, and hear his message. He speaks with an Australian accent, but it's a message that the world should listen to. You can fly now vicariously. I hope someday we can have Hertz rent a sub and fly actually anywhere in the ocean we want to go, including to the deepest place, where 51 years ago, once and never more, people went to the deepest place, the Mariana Trench. It's not good enough that it was once and never more. We have presently a handful of submersibles that can go, you know, to about half the ocean's depth. Russia has three, Japan has one, France has one sub that can go to 6,000 meters. China is building a 7,000 meter sub. India is getting into the game. We got out of the game when the Sea Cliff was retired in 1998. The Alvin, blessed Alvin, workhorse of submersibles that take people, not just cameras and sensors to the deep sea, but take people down, is in the process of getting renovated and will go to about 6,000 meters, deeper than it has in the past, but not quite deep enough. We need to go to full ocean depth, and now it's taking private initiative with Jim Cameron and Richard Branson, and why not others, jumping in to do what it takes to get us to the deepest place in the sea. Why? Because we need to understand this ocean from the inside out, top to bottom. Why do we need to take care of the ocean? Because the ocean takes care of us. Never before have we known as much as we now do, and never again will we have as good a chance to take care of it. My wish with TED was to encourage people to use their powers, whatever they are, to ignite public support, to explore, to understand the ocean, to engage, to protect the blue heart of the planet with a network of protected areas. We're only this far toward the goal of taking care of the real hope spot. That would be Earth itself, an idea worth spreading. Thank you.